This is Bob Ambrogi, and I am here today getting a briefing of a new feature just released from Fileread. And here to tell us all about it is Chan Koh, the CEO and co-founder of the company. Chan, welcome.
Hey Bob, thanks for having me.
So I know you've just released this new deep search agent that we're going to be talking about, you're going to be showing me today. But just for people who are watching this who maybe don't have a lot of familiarity with the company, why don't you kind of quickly give us the background on Fileread and what you do?
Yeah. So what Fileread does is we're building AI agents for litigators and investigators to help them really interrogate documents using natural language. And really what our focus has mainly been on is being able to interrogate large document volumes. And so deep search is the first agentic search experience that has been launched in Relativity. And the goal behind that is to really be able to leverage all the different search strategies like keywords, metadata, and semantic, and combine all the best results from each search strategy into one cohesive narrative so that they can go in and see what where the answer may have come from.
And as we are talking, it's just a few days before Relativity Fest is going to be happening in Chicago. And I know you're going to be there exhibiting. So anybody who's watching this who wants to get more details or wants to see a demo for themselves, head to your booth in the exhibit hall and check it out, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm also giving a talk on Wednesday at 2:45. So regarding AI agents use cases in litigation and how it's evolving. Please stop by if you have time on that one as well.
All right, good. Well, why don't we get right into it? Why don't you tell us what it is that you've launched here with this deep search agent and
sure.
Go ahead and demo it.
All right, perfect. So really what our goal with this tool was, first, Fileread started off as like a chat interface similar to ChatGPT, but the ability to interrogate large document sets, but also provide what we call annotations or highlights to the documents themselves. The problem with that approach, I mean, it's still very useful, is that people were concerned about how do I know you looked at everything? Like, how do I know you considered the different keywords or maybe the different metadata fields and not just the semantic meaning behind the four corners of the document? And so really our goal behind building this tool was so that how do we combine all the different search term capabilities, the metadata capabilities, the things that e-discovery folks or people doing associates doing document review would be able to leverage and build an agent that can connect and run those different types of functions and then bring all the documents that are likely to be relevant from there and then create that narrative so that they can go in and explore and make decisions on their data. And this is really kind of our way of trying to become the legal data intelligence layer. Starting in Relativity, we want to become a little bit more, how do we help you interact with your data? How do we help you make decisions on your data using natural language? Because I think typically that's how people think, and we want the tools to really mold around the way people think about how they work instead of having them have to learn a new tool entirely.
And so you're in Relativity One here.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we have a integration into Relativity One. It also works on RHEL Server, but I know Server is being deprecated pretty soon. It should still work in both use cases, but in this workspace we have the McKinsey opioid and Purdue litigation documents from UCSF industry docs. Everyone likes to use the Enron or the Jeb Bush data set, and we wanted to use something that's a little bit more, I guess, more fresh. I mean, large language models have been trained on a huge corpus of data that probably includes Enron and maybe this one. This is a pretty publicly famous litigation and people know enough about it that they can actually ask questions against it. And so some of the typical things that people would want to do is like, all right, I want to identify communications, like demonstrating McKinsey's internal acknowledgement of Oxy's addictive nature or public health risk associated with increased opioid prescribing. And so how this tool works is first it understands like the query first and it builds out a plan of what it's going to do. In this case, like, yeah, it's going to build a query plan. It's like, all right, you said communication. So likely you're going to want to look at emails, maybe chat or Slack messages. I don't think McKinsey or Purdue use Slack. So we're going to be focusing on emails in this case. And initially it's going to start with a keyword version of the search. And so it builds a keyword search query. So the AI can currently look at up to 1,000 results, but if you want to see the full result set, you can actually click view safe search and that takes you here. So it looks like we have about 3,000 documents that were considered to be hits on those keywords. And if we go in and see what keywords were actually returned, it's here. So yeah, OxyContin addictive, or addictive nature of OxyContin, addictive risk. So this wasn't done by a human. This was actually done by Fileread. Fileread generated these keyword search terms. So Relativity uses a DT search as a syntax for generating keyword search terms. And sometimes that can get pretty difficult and cumbersome to do, especially when you're trying to figure out what keywords to even use when it's related to a certain topic. And we help you kind of turn this into like a starting point. So you don't have to take this as the full ground truth, but this is a way for you to see, oh, I can kind of start to see the black box that this AI is doing. What is it? What documents is it considering? How is it considering these documents? And you can start to see why it picked these keywords.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And yeah, the goal is to really just provide transparency into each step. And then what happens next is we're going to then filter these documents and rank them for analysis. So we definitely look at the filtered list, truncate it down. So this one is mostly going to be just the top 200 based on the ranking. If it's slow, I think this is probably, it's not us. I think it's just the way that Relativity sometimes, because it's doing a database call, it can get a little bit slow, but it takes the top 200. There we go. And then from here, we want to look at
a decision based on, is that 200 a decision based on, what's that 200 limit based on? Is that based on something in Relativity or on your own choice, or?
It's our own choice, because our insights, our general insights tool, like the ChatGPT experience, we show up to 200. So there is context with no limitations anyway. So if we want to provide now that the narrative that people can actually go in and actually see what the answers might be, those are the documents that we choose to be the likely the best candidates there. And then it reviews the final document text, goes through these, and then tries to identify and builds that story of what likely is going to be the relevant here. And then based on the aggregated documents that were picked, we provide like a narrative, and we also provide citations where actually users can go in and see where the answer may have come from in those documents, because this is very important. I know hallucinations are still a big fear that attorneys have, and we want to make sure that here's what the model picked when making this decision. All opioids expose patients to serious risk, so it's very related to the query that we just discussed. Identifying communications, demonstrating their internal acknowledgement. So this is definitely what our field teams currently talk about. Yeah, they acknowledge, someone at McKinsey definitely acknowledged that opioids are exposing patients to serious risk, and it understood that OxyContin is related to opioids. And if users like these results, so it looks like 42 documents were picked as the highest likelihood, you can create a safe search and they can do whatever they need. Either they need to code or tag them a certain way, or they need to send it to someone else. Maybe the partner is asking, hey, I'm looking for these documents that relate to communications about this particular topic. They can go in and quickly look at this digested version of the documents so that they can go in and make decisions on them. And then, yeah, we now support tabular views internally. In the chat itself, we used to only do just pure text. So it definitely looks a lot cleaner, more organized. And we're continuing to make improvements so that the right now deep search has to be enabled on a per workspace basis. But what we want to do based on the inspiration that we've gotten from GPT-5 is that if the question is looking for more comprehensiveness or lists of documents, or we feel that it needs to look at metadata, it should just do that automatically instead of having to go into a particular deep search mode. And so those are some of the improvements that we're looking to make. But because this is relatively new, we wanted to get this out there and into the hands of the users. This is how we're currently built it out, to see how people end up taking this.
Yeah. So you already have the kind of the Q&A feature. How do these sort of interface with each other in terms of deep search versus Q&A?
So it's still the same process in terms of like the modality on how you interact with the tool is through a Q&A process. What deep search does, it does take a little bit longer because it's trying to build, as you saw here, it's trying to build that set of search strategies, and it's going to go in and execute, look at those documents and make decisions at each step. So it does take a little bit longer than a general insights chat. Insights chat is what you would call, I think, zero shot prompting, where you give it a question, then it answers based on the RAG pipeline that we built. So that, and it returns the most highly relevant documents and highlights the responsive areas in those documents for the user. In this case, this is a little bit more comprehensive. If you need more lists of documents, you can actually get access to a lot more sources. You can kind of start to see what decisions the models are making by looking at the keyword searches, how they crafted the metadata fields and things like that. So that's why we wanted to build it a little bit this way, so that this is, I think, builds a lot more trust with the user on like, what are the steps that the model is taking? What decisions is it making at each step, so that it can start to see, oh, I see where it went wrong potentially, or it can inspire them to actually go in and use this search to generate new searches for something else. If they find a document that, for example, they didn't expect to see because they maybe previously dismissed it, but in this context, it made a lot of sense. I think that's the goal of providing a lot more comprehensiveness to the answers.
Does the user have any input on or ability to modify the decisions that it makes?
So currently at each step, no. But what we can offer, what the users can do is they can go into the safe search, either make a copy of it, or they could readjust the query to add additional keyword search terms, add email, add more metadata fields, but by custodian or maybe by other different fields that they might be caring about, for example, privilege or responsiveness. So they can basically take the list of documents that were returned to do additional work on top of that. But at the moment, they're not able to make edits here a bit yet. The only way to do that is to prompt it a little bit differently.
Can I follow up on results with a refinement prompt, modify the results in some way by doing that?
So currently we treat every particular search as independent. And the reason why is we wanted to really maximize the use of the context window limitations that we have. And so there is a huge benefit to maintaining context in some form, but we have heard from folks that have used these other tools that do preserve context. The model can get into what they call like a rabbit hole that it cannot get out of. And so they end up having to just create a new query and start from scratch over again. A bit of a trade-off that we're making right now, where we think for now the independent ones is good enough, but we are building some enhancements so that it can start to clarify with the user, oh, what exactly are you looking for? Are you referring to the previous question that you just asked? We can then limit the documents or limit the query to only look at those set of documents. Or if it's referencing maybe some of the actions it took on a previous step, it can expand upon that later. But that is something that we are working on. I know Anthropic just released their context engineering paper. We are definitely taking a heavy look at that and seeing how we can use that those techniques that they've used in order to enhance the experience for the end user on our side as well.
Yeah. I know you alluded to this briefly earlier in this demonstration, but if I'm a customer of Relativity One and I'm a user of Relativity One, which has some of its own search capabilities, some of its own AI capabilities, what does this bring to me that I can't already get out of Relativity?
Great question. So I think if you're referring to the Relativity Air offerings, so Air for Review is geared more towards making decisions on each individual document, meaning it's going to look at every document, the four corners of each document, and code it for either privilege, responsive, or whatever decision that the users want. We're doing it more on an aggregate level. We're trying to help you identify documents at scale, make decisions, AI-driven search experience. I know Relativity is building a chatbot. Remains to be seen exactly. I've seen like a demo of it, but right now it's only pointed at the documentation. I think they're going to do some interesting things with that regardless when it's pointed at the documents. But in terms of the scale at which we can handle the volume, I think we haven't seen any other tool or anything that Relativity has come out with just yet that's similar to what we're doing.
Helpful. That's helpful. Yeah, I haven't seen anything like that either. And actually, I haven't even seen their chatbot. So you're a step ahead of me on that.
Gotcha.
Great. Anything else that you wanted to show about this or say about this?
No, I think really what this is very useful for is just finding lists of documents. And I think the way that people have been using Fileread in general, along with the Relativity Air products that you mentioned, was one of our customers mentioned that she starts with Fileread to come up with a list of documents to put into Relativity Air using prompts. I think they actually use Fileread to come up with interesting prompts or identify collections of documents that are likely to be the most relevant. She starts with those to build the prompts in the Relativity Air for Review platform, runs it, and then collects the ones that potentially aren't relevant or has come up as like maybe attorney needs to potentially check the result of that one. And she puts those back into Fileread for analysis again, just to do a QC check. So even if we're kind of in overlapping spaces, it seems like people have found use cases where our tools actually complement each other very well. And so we're very happy to like support that use case and continue to build on top and make the platform even better.
Yeah, makes sense. Well, that looks great. I really appreciate your giving us this demonstration today.
Thank you so much.
And this is out there now, right? I mean, this is you've released this, is ready and
correct. Yeah, we have I think 3 customers that have. We're slowly releasing it out. It does take some setup on our side to enable it on a workspace by workspace level. So we are monitoring who gets to use it initially, but it should be available for general release within the next 2 quarters.
All right, great. Well, Chan, thanks a lot, and look forward to seeing you at Relativity.
Yeah, likewise. Please stop by the booth.
I'll do that. All right, thanks.